Okay, so let's continue. Now, so in a similar way, we could also comment about computation of OP coefficients in the CFT, but maybe that we can leave for the discussion if you want to hear about it. And I would proceed to tell you something about the OR model in two dimensions, okay? So let me erase this. So let's now discuss the OR model in D equal to. So the first thing we have to do, we're gonna, in principle, we would like to follow the same steps as we followed in three dimensions. So we start again from looking at the vacuum, okay? So we look at vacuum, which means that we need to minimize the effective potential. And the two equations that we get by requiring the stationarity of the effective potential are again, the first one is this. The simple one, and then there was a more sophisticated one, which is 0 equal phi squared minus m squared, small m squared, divided by 2 lambda. And here let me put already the renormalized mass. And what I have here is so let me just explain a second. So this came, if you remember, we showed yesterday the computation of the trace of minus box plus m squared, right? And we had a computation also in D equals 2. And the computation in D equals 2 had, so we expanded our answer in generic D, we took the limit, there was a pole, there was a finite piece, and there was this log, okay? So what am I doing here? I put the pole and the finite term. Just I chose to swallow also the finite term inside the definition of my renormalized mass squared parameter. And what I'm left with is this logarithm, and I have here a scale that I need to put, and this is going to be my Dirac scale mu, okay? So as a result, I should think about this normalized mass as a normalized mass at this Dirac scale mu, okay? So these are now my vacuum equations. So the only thing I need to be careful is to put the divergences inside the normalization of the mass. So this seems innocuous, but actually this logarithm has a pretty dramatic consequence. And the dramatic consequence is that you see very easily that the second equation cannot have any solution with m squared 0, you see? Because if I try to put big m squared 0, this thing gives me a divergence, okay? I don't have solutions with m squared equals 0, and so I'm forced to consider the solution of the first equation in which phi a is equal to zero and m squared is different from zero. So that's the only allowed solution. And it's the symmetry preserving phase. Okay. So what we discovered is that there is no phase with spontaneous breaking of one, and this is related to a general statement for quantum field theories in two dimensions. So no symmetry breaking phase, and this is a manifestation of a general result . The general result is what is known as Coleman-Mermin-Wagner. Theorem. Let's call it theorem. The Coleman-Mermin-Wagner theorem is that which says that basically there are no Goldstone bosons in two dimensions. Okay, so it's impossible to break spontaneously. Have spontaneous breaking of a continuous symmetry. So what's the physical reason for this? So the physical reason for this is that we have to remember that the reason why symmetry breaking is even possible in quantum field theory is that we have this different vacua, right? Which are related to each other by a symmetry transformation, but it's very important that we somehow forbid tunneling between them, because otherwise, if we would be able to tunnel between these vacua, we would have the true ground state would be a combination of the two, it would be a symmetric combination of the two. That's why in quantum mechanics, in ordinary quantum mechanics for a particle on a line, we don't have this symmetry breaking phenomenon. So, and that's also the reason why it's very important to be at infinite volume to have spontaneous symmetry breaking, okay? So it so happens, if you think about it for a second, that when you're dealing with a continuous symmetry, if you are just in one spatial dimension, you don't have a barrier that gives you an infinite potential barrier between the two vacua which are related by the continuous symmetry transformation. And so that's why we can tunnel between them and spontaneous breaking does not happen. Okay? Another way that is often presented is by saying that there are IR divergences associated to the massless scalars in two dimensions. So if we would pretend to put ourselves in the spontaneous breaking vacuum, then we would encounter these IR divergences, which would mean that we did something wrong. Okay, so I just want to comment that, you see, the fact that this solution is not allowed, it's very clear for any value of the normalized m squared parameter in our, so no matter how negative we take m squared, we don't have this kind of solutions. On the other hand, if you would be doing ordinary perturbation theory, and you would decide to put a negative mass squared in your Lagrangian, even in D equals 2, then the only way you would know how to proceed is to actually get to actually give a VEV to the phi and try to do some computation around this fake vacuum. And you would then discover that you have IR divergences. So you would be a bit confused. Well, thanks to large N, we immediately see already at reading order that that would be a wrong vacuum to consider. Okay. So let's now go ahead and actually solve that equation. Let's go ahead and actually solve that equation. So in other words, what I'm saying, what I was saying before is that even though we know that this result is true, it's still confusing the manifestation of it in perturbation theory, in ordinary perturbation theory, while thanks to large N, we see it immediately. So the equation, oh, this is not a good chalk. Let me take a good chalk. This is good. So and so. So. So what is the equation for the mass squared of our excitations? We can rewrite it in this more beautiful form. Okay, and now if you exponentiate both sides, you get this m squared times the exponent of m squared over 2 lambda is equal to mu squared times the exponent, I forgot the pi, right? Yes, I wanted to put 2 pi m squared and over lambda, not over 2 lambda. Okay? And here we get 2 pi m ren squared over lambda. So what we see is that even though here we have a combination that in which the Dirac scale appears, we see that in this combination, mu disappears. Okay, so the dependence on mu from the prefactor is precisely compensated by the dependence on mu inside of this m squared. So it's an RG invariant scale. Okay, which is related in this way on physical parameters such as the physical mass. This is the physical mass squared. And this is our coupling. Okay. So in particular, you can compute the running of this coupling. And let's write it here. We can compute that derivative with respect to log mu of over lambda is minus 1 over pi. Okay. So that's a very simple RG equation. This is exact at one loop at leading order large n. Okay. And so what do I want to say? Just a small comment is that there is an interesting limit of this in which we take our mass squared parameter to be negative and large, okay? So let's make this comment. So if we take lambda and m squared going to infinity with fixed ratio, and m squared negative. Okay. So what happens is that if you think about it, it's like now by taking the mass very large and negative, we are forcing our scalar fields to live on the sphere. Okay. So this limit corresponds to a sigma model with target space the sphere. Okay. You can just see it by looking at the Lagrangian. If you look at the Lagrangian, you see that, let me call this sigma hat, and this is phi a squared minus n here. I just mean minus m squared over 2 lambda, which is 1 over 2t. Okay? So now if you take the limit that I just said, you see this guy goes away, and sigma just behaves as a Lagrange multiplier that forces our fields to live on the sphere with this radius. Okay? And the calculation that we did of this beta function, this calculation that we did is just rephrased in this limit as saying that the coupling T has a negative beta function. So there is asymptotic freedom for this sigma model. Calculation of gives the beta function for this T coupling, which is just the radius of the sigma model. The leading order is just minus T squared over pi. Okay, so this means that we have asymptotic freedom. And a dynamically generated scale. So we started with a theory that were massless scalars parameterizing a sphere. So that's what we get in this limit. Massless scalars that classically, these are massless scalars that parameterize a sphere. But then at the quantum level, there is this beta function that generates a scale, and this scale gives mass to our fields, okay? So we can, roughly speaking, we can say that our Goldstone boson get a mass from this dynamically generated scale. And this is again a manifestation of the Coleman-Bermi-Wagner result. And so what did we discover about 2D? So now we did a brief parenthesis about the sigma model, but we discovered that basically the complete left half of our phase diagram does not exist. We are always forced to be in the symmetry preserving phase. We could go ahead and do very similar things than what we did in three dimensions in the only phase that we have, which is the symmetry preserving one. We could go and compute the scattering of the vector particles, but we are not going to do it because it's very similar, right? We just have to compute the propagator of sigma, do this little integral for the bubble, and get and we go look at the analytic structure, etc. And so the big difference with 3D is that we don't have, for instance, we don't have the phase transition, so we don't have any CFT, and we don't have the phase with Goldstone bosons because Goldstone bosons do not exist, okay? I think this basically, yes, this concludes the discussion of the one model. Are there questions? Yes? Sorry, can you repeat?
At the higher critical point, if you switch on the mass correction, mm-hmm. will
it flow to the two phases? Yeah. That's the right way to think about it. So, exactly. So here I'm just drawing the m squared, but okay, our theory is two parameters, like m squared and lambda, if you wish. So the way we thought about this was to first set m squared to some value and then study the theory as a function of lambda. But you can also think about it in a different way. You can decide to, for instance, put yourself here, right? Then do the RG in lambda as we did. We do the RG in lambda, we go to the IR CFT. So we are lambda equals infinity. Then here there is our CFT. And then the CFT has a relevant deformation, okay? This relevant deformation in this case is going to be, what is it going to be? It's going to be the sigma squared, the sigma field, right? Just like in the UV, we had m squared was proportional to the phi phi operator. In the AR, we can think about it as the sigma operator. And the sigma operator, we can turn it on with either sign in our Lagrangian. And it's going to move us to either the symmetry preserving phase or the symmetry broken phase. Is it clear?
Yeah, I think the symmetry
phase in the 2D would be the same one in the phi still exists. We didn't eliminate phi. The only thing that happened is that the operator phi squared, so the bilinear, got replaced by the Hubbard-Satanovich field. Right, so the amplitude here will be just the same that we computed before in the limit of array large lambda. So you can just take the amplitude we computed. So the only thing you need to do is to take whatever we computed before, it was something like this, and you know you just have to set throw this, and you get the answer for what you find by deforming the CFT. Is it clear? So if we deform... No, there are also the vector particles. You would still find the vector particles, right? You can understand it from the fact that we computed the scattering amplitude of the vector particles here, right? We did the computation for any lambda, and there is no problem whatsoever in just taking the limit of lambda going to infinity. Okay, yes?
Hold
Yes, let me think. So it's a little bit subtle, the interplay between this column Mermin Wagner and Largen. Let me explain what I mean. I mean that there are some cases in which it works in the opposite direction. Like you would expect that there is no symmetry breaking in two dimensions, but then since you are at Largen, you still see it happen. So, but you have to remember what was the reason why symmetry breaking is not supposed to happen in two dimensions. The reason why symmetry breaking is not supposed to happen is because you don't have an infinite potential barrier, okay? So sometimes it so may happen that the actual potential barrier in your theory scales like n, okay? So then you take the limit n to infinity, and then, look, all of a sudden I again have an infinite potential barrier, so symmetry breaking can happen, okay? This is not the case here, okay? So here, the potential barrier remains finite even at infinite n. And perhaps one way to think about it is also in terms of the IR divergences, right? So the question is, how many would be Goldstone bosons you would be producing, right? In this case, we would be producing a number of would be Goldstone bosons that scales like n. So already at leading order large n, the IR divergence is in our face. While in other cases, if you have just one Goldstone boson that you would be producing, then maybe the IR divergences would be subleading, and then it doesn't appear to be there at leading order large n. So the leading order large n doesn't know about this IR divergence, and then it tells you the fake answer that there is symmetry breaking. Okay? So, yeah, so that's the here, since we have a large number of Goldstone bosons already at leading order, we get the right answer, namely that no Goldstone bosons are there at the quantum level. Okay, any other question? Yes? Sorry, can you say louder?
Sorry. If you were to turn off both m squared and lambda, you think we should still recover
CF? Well, with a little bit of so there is a small caveat that, strictly speaking, the CFT in 2D is when you take the bosons to be compact. So here we are taking this. Our scalars are not compact to start with, and so it's a bit weird because you have these logarithms in the correlation functions. So yeah, but okay, we are more interested in the IR, but yeah, the UV is a little bit weird because of this non-compactness of the scalars. Other questions? Okay, so now we're gonna continue our list of examples. And the next example I want to discuss is the one of the Gros-Neve theory at Largen. And okay, I'm a little bit slow, I get confused. So we had until 11, so until 12:45 in principle, okay? So let's discuss now the next example. And hopefully today we are gonna finish with it. So we are not gonna do as a thorough analysis as we did for the ON, but because also we can use that many things are similar to what we just discussed. And the goal is to try to finish it for today, and so that then next week we can concentrate on the QCD theories. So this is a theory of self-interacting fermions, and the Lagrangian is as follows. So we have psi A, minus g over 2n psi a squared. Okay? Let's just immediately specify the dimension here, since we are dealing with fermions a little bit. It's better to do like that. So let's first discuss the Gross-Neve model in three dimensions, okay? So let's start. D equals 3. So I forgot to say that this index A goes from 1 to n. So again, we have our field, which is a vector of a symmetry. And our psi A is going to be a Dirac spinner in 3D. So the Dirac spinner, as you might know, is like in three dimensions, is a two component complex spinner. And it's just, you can think about it as a combination of two Majorana spinners, okay? So Majorana spinners, which are just doublets of SL2R. Okay, SL2R is the double cover of the Lorentz group in three dimensions. So for a moment now I switch to Lorentzian, if you allow me. So this is a double cover of the Lorentz group in three dimensions, and so the spinners are just real doublets of SL2R, and the Dirac is a complex one. So, but this is just actually a bit of a, so if you rewrite this in terms of Majorana components, you see that it also takes a very natural form. I just have the contraction of all my Majorana components. I just, so for some reason, I prefer to use Dirac because it's mostly a notational preference. So in the way we wrote the Lagrangian, so the manifest symmetry is un, but actually there is an O to n symmetry, because we can also rotate all the 2n Majorana among each other, okay? Another important, another symmetry that is going to be important in our discussion is space-time reflection symmetry. For the reflection symmetry, you can think about it as, for instance, taking the direction 2 and sending it to minus itself. Okay, so 2 here is not an exponent, it's really, I mean, the second component of my vector. Okay? And so to understand how this acts on the spinners, think about a vector made out of the spinners, right? So what do we expect for this vector? We expect that v0 and 1 should go to v0 and 1, and v2 should go to minus v2, right? Because it's a vector. So under a reflection, it should behave like this. And one way to get this is to simply act. So to get this, we can get it with the following action on the spinner. We just send psi to gamma 2 psi. Okay, this works. And I should also mention that I'm using now the following conventions for the gammas. gamma mu gamma nu equals 2 eta mu nu, with eta being minus plus plus. Okay. But to discuss these properties of the spinners for a moment, it's better to go to the Lorentzian, because at the end of the day, that they are a bit simpler for the to discuss in the Lorentzian signature. Okay, so this is the action of the reflection. This is the action of the reflection, and I should also say that since we saw that it's SL2R, this means that these matrices are actually real. I can take the Pierre-Michel. Okay, so now, given that action of the reflection, an important thing that happens is that the thing that I want you to pay attention to is that the mass term, that mass that we wrote, is odd under this reflection symmetry. So mass term is odd. Okay, if you write psi bar psi, this under a reflection goes to minus, which is minus psi bar psi. I should have said that because I'm using here that psi is equal to psi dagger gamma zero. Okay. So if you do the calculation, you find this. Okay. So M is a real parameter and it flips under this symmetry that we might call Z2 reflection. Okay, it flips under the space-time symmetry that flips. It flips under space-time symmetry that reflects one direction. That's the first thing I wanted to say. Now, another thing that we need to observe about the Lagrangian that you wrote is that the coupling G, let's look at the scaling with energy of the coupling G. So this quartic interaction has the following mass dimension. Let me do it in generic D. So here you see I put the scaling of D plus 4 times the scaling of a fermion. This should be equal to D. And this gives me that the mass dimension of G is 2 minus D, which in D equals 3 is minus 1. Okay? So our quartic interaction now has a negative dimension. It's a negative mass dimension. Or in other words, it's an irrelevant deformation of the free fermionic theory. So we should really think about the Lagrangian that we wrote there as a effective theory, effective Lagrangian for the fermions, which is only valid up to some UV cutoff, right? Because we added this irrelevant deformation. So, should be seen as a low energy effective theory. And for instance, we can get it. It can come from Yukawa by integrating out a massive scalar field. Integrating out a massive scalar. Okay. So that's also useful to understand why we put that sign. Maybe for some of you it was confusing why we wrote minus psi squared. You might say, ah, but this is correct, this is wrong, I'm not sure. So if you want to check that it's correct, just get this theory. That's precisely what they write actually in the original paper. They say the sign is this because we get it out of Yukawa. Okay, if you want to be consistent with RG, you're also going to have to put some factor of the fourth interaction. So suppose you take this theory, then you do the exchange of the scalar between the fermions, and you get, what do you get? Get minus y over root n minus y over root n from the two vertices, and here you get the propagator, which is positive as well. Right? So in total you get something like y squared over n 1 over p squared plus m phi squared. Correct me if I'm wrong. And in the if I take m very large, it becomes y squared over n and phi squared, and you can compare it with the Feynman rule coming from our quartic interaction, right? The Feynman rule coming from our quartic interaction is just from our quartic interaction between the fermions, we get G over n. Okay, I'm a bit, now I'm not really taking care of all the factors, but it's certainly proportional to g over n. So you see that g is proportional to y squared over n phi squared, it's positive. Okay, so g is a positive coupling. And another thing that you see from here, you remember the, one of the first comments we made about the ON was that if we compare it with the exchange of a scalar, it had the opposite sign, right? So it was a repulsive interaction. Well, here we see that it has the same sign. Our quartic interaction, it has the same sign as the exchange of a scalar. In fact, we can get it from the exchange of a scalar. And this means that in this case, the interaction is attractive. Interaction is attractive. Okay, that's an important difference. So now let me just tell you, I guess one thing that for sure we are going to have time to do, I don't know about the rest, but one thing that we're going to have time to do is to derive the phase diagram at large n. So let me first give you the answer and then we are going to derive it. So what we are going to see is the following phase diagram. At large n. And let me draw it in a two-parameter space of this coupling G and the mass m squared. Okay. So what large n is going to bias, again, like in the previous case, is that we can take G to be large, and still our analysis will be reliable. And we have the following results. So as long as, so as soon as m squared, in this case, We can really write reliably m squared equals zero. This does not depend on any, sorry, I shouldn't have to write, so for a fermion it's m that is important, not m squared. I made a mistake, so write m. I can really write m equals zero because we said that m breaks a symmetry, right? So m equals zero is a reliable thing to say. So as long as as soon as I'm away from the m equals zero line, the Z2 symmetry is broken explicitly. It's broken explicitly. And here instead, I am on this magic line. There is this magic line where the Z2 symmetry is preserved. And the interesting thing that happens is that as we crank up our G, okay, so if we are in perturbation theory, we need to take G small. But here we are going to be able to crank up our G, and we encounter some critical value, G critical. And when we are before this critical value, the Z2 symmetry is preserved. While when we go above this critical value, G critical, what happens is that there is spontaneous breaking of this reflection symmetry. Okay? There is spontaneous breaking of the symmetry. So again, we have these two different phases separated by a phase transition. And again, here there is going to be some CFT sitting, some interacting CFT that one might be interested in. That, not surprisingly, is called Gros-Neve CFT. And here instead, we have just the free fermion CFT. Okay. And if we rely on perturbation theory, you're only able to see something that sits on the low edge of this diagram. Okay, large N is really what allows us to discover what happens beyond. Now, it's going to be the other way around. From this CFT, you can flow to the free theory. Yes. So the RG is going to go in the opposite direction. So, just as a comment, when we are above G critical, it's nice to draw a picture of the potential as we move across the line. So, what's going to happen here is what happens is that on this part of the line we have an explicit breaking of the Z2 symmetry. Okay. And on this other side, we have the opposite form, the opposite shape of the potential. And here we have a first order transition. So when we are precisely at m equals zero, there is the spontaneous breaking of the Z2. Okay. At the moment, it might be not immediately clear what this is a potential for. But basically, you can think about it as a potential for the bilinear in the fermions. Or if you prefer, you can be completed with the scalar field that we saw before. And this would be like the potential for that real scalar. OK? So that's what happens above G critical. We have this first order transition. And at the end of the line of first order transitions, we have a second order one. Okay, so now how are we going to go ahead and do some calculations in this theory? Now, probably you already imagine, but we're going to do it in the same way as we did for the ON. So the first thing to do is to use auxiliary fields to rewrite our Lagrangian. So you see the novelty is that now here we have a plus sign because we had this minus g. So now it's not true anymore that this sigma should be thought as imaginary. This sigma is now can be thought of as real. In fact, it's a relative of the real scalar. But okay, so what I did now is just, again, to just rewrite the quartic interaction using an auxiliary field. And with the same logic as we used for the sigma is our Abba-Stratonovich auxiliary field. And with the same logic as we used for the scalar, now what we're gonna do is to compute the path integral over the our fields with indices. And this is gonna lead to some trace log, okay? You see, now we can be a little bit faster because many things are similar to the bosonic theory, so we don't need to. But okay, of course, stop me if I'm going too fast and I skip some step that you don't understand. I also want to mention the equation of motion. Again, the equation of motion for sigma now is going to relate sigma to the bilinear in the fermionic fields. Okay. So to resum diagrams. Again, what we do is to add the trace log. We simply add the trace log with the same logic as before. There is another difference to be careful about. And the difference is that when we do the path integral over the fermions, the determinant comes with a different sign, right? Because now we have a determinant in the numerator instead of the denominator. So if previously we had a plus trace log, now we're going to have a minus trace log. Okay, just because now the determinant is in the numerator. And here we have this beautiful operator to compute the trace log of. Okay. Again? Yes. So, right. So that's why I call this effective here. It's the same logic that you use in the scalar case. So this is a bit of a fake Lagrangian. I'm just using it to say that I can still insert my fermion fields on the external legs, and then all the internal loops of the fermionic fields are included in this trace log. Okay? But I can still compute amplitudes or correlation functions involving the psi's, okay? Just all the internal loops are included here. So I should not double count. So let's do the vacua of this theory. We can do the vacua. No, it's better to erase that one. An advantage compared to the bosonic theory is that now we have only sigma that can possibly get a valve, right? Because psi, it's better not take a valve. Okay, so let's compute the vacua. So we just plug sigma, let me use the same notation that I have here. Sigma hat plus square root of n sigma, so that's the fluctuation, and that's our order root n one-point function. And similarly to what we did in the bosonic case, we then introduce a physical mass parameter. The physical mass parameter is just small m plus capital sigma. I'm just saying that the bulk of sigma is going to shift the mass of the fermions, okay? And so the vacuum equation now, again, is going to receive contribution only from this quadratic term and from the trace log. So the equation, stationarity of the effective potential of just gives m minus m, big M minus small m divided by G, minus the trace of 1 over gamma mu d mu plus capital M must be equal to 0. Okay, so that's the equation we get. And our next task is to go and compute this trace. Okay? Let's go and compute this trace. How do we compute it? Now we are going to be, we need to use two symbols, one for the trace of the operator, one for the trace over the spinor indices, not to get confused. So this we can immediately write as an integral in d3p over 2 pi cubed. And now this big T, this big trace means the trace over the spinor indices, okay? And this becomes I p mu gamma mu minus m divided by minus p squared minus s squared. Basically, I multiply numerator and denominator by this thing. So in the denominator, I get minus p squared minus m squared. And that's what I have in the numerator. Now, the trace of gamma mu is 0, and the trace of the identity is 2, because my fermions are 2 component. So I'm left with 2m times the integral and that's the integral that we computed before, right? Precisely the one that we computed for the scalar. So in dimrag, I would just get 2m square root of m squared. Now, in this case, since we are dealing with a theory that is not normalizable, I find it a little bit more transparent to actually work with a hard cutoff. So if you don't mind, let's instead use the formula with the hard cutoff. So we're going to explicitly have some UV cutoff in our formula. So with the hard cutoff, we find instead this answer. So the integral is just lambda uv over 2 pi squared minus 1 over 4 pi modulus of m. Okay? So this absolute value is just the square, so also here I can rewrite it as minus 1 over 2 pi m absolute value of m, okay? because now you see in the scalar theory the variable was really m squared, but in the fermionic theory the variable is really m, no? So I'm allowed to put an absolute value here. Makes sense. And so let me plug the answer with the hard cutoff. I find 1 over pi squared lambda uv times m minus 1 over 2 pi m absolute value of m. Okay? It's just a simple calculation. Okay, so now let's put this back in our equation. Let's plug this back in our equation, and the equation becomes m minus m over g, and here I just copy, plus 1 over pi squared lambda uv m minus 1 over 2 pi m absolute value of m equals 0. Okay? And let's also consider the symmetry preserving line, m equals 0, small m equals 0, I no explicit breaking. Let's restrict there. And then we have basically found that the derivative of our potential up to prefactors of n is 1 over g minus lambda over pi squared m. There is this linear term. The linear term depends on 1 over g and the uv cutoff. And then there is this beautiful quadratic term. That's our derivative. So let's draw the shape of this derivative. Maybe let's take the full blackboard to do this drawing. Let's draw the shape of this derivative. In two cases, so let's consider first 1 over g bigger than lambda over pi squared, okay? This means that the linear term is positive, right? The linear term is positive, and so our potential goes something like this, okay? You see that for positive m, this is a positive quadratic term, and for the quadratic term is positive, while for negative m, the quadratic term is negative, right? And if you now go and think very deeply, you find that this corresponds to the potential, which is like this, okay? This is the shape, very roughly, of the potential. Now let's consider, so let me write this somewhere else. So this is in the 1 over g bigger than lambda over pi squared. Instead, if we consider now the the other case, so now you see, if 1 over g is smaller than lambda over pi squared, then the linear term is negative, the linear term. So the derivative of the potential goes something like this. Okay, it's a very schematic drawing. And you see now the derivative is 0 in 3 points. The derivative is not 0 in 3 points. And this corresponds to this shape of the potential. It corresponds to the shape of the potential like this. Okay? This is our V. Okay, let me draw it better. And these two additional critical points happen at, so for instance, this one is 2 pi lambda over pi squared minus 1 over g. Okay? So you see that in this case, z2 is spontaneously broken. Right? Are there questions about this? Is it clear? It's just a calculation of the effective potential. And you see that, as we expected, this corresponds to small g, right? Small g is when 1 over g is big. And this instead corresponds to large g, okay? When g is large, we see the emergence of this spontaneous breaking phase. So I just derived what I had promised before. And just a few comments on this result. Yep.
If we consider if we add a kinetic term for signality, then can we say it's a UV completion of this theory? Like
you have. What is a UV completion of this theory? Sorry, I didn't understand the subject.
So can you
Precisely, so exactly. So you can go from the Yukawa theory. We already said that the Yukawa UV completes this effective field theory that we are studying. And sigma, you can see it as doing some scaling of the Lagrangian of the real scalar in such a way that the kinetic term you can throw away, okay? Basically, Yukawa divided by the mass, yes.
Yeah, so then this theory is only valid when lambda is less than.
I'm going to make now some comments about the validity of this, okay? So bear with me for a second. So let's make some comments along the lines of what is being asked. So. We can think of lambda as the scale below which we can trust the EFT. If you want, that's one way to think about it. And then it's convenient to just write the dimensionful, like the relevant coupling, just like G. We can write it by putting explicitly a scale of an inverse power of the cutoff. So let's rewrite this quartic interaction as some coefficient C, okay, and then you see how strong our interaction is depends on the value of this C. You can think about it in this way. And what we found is that the inverse of G critical is lambda over pi squared. So in this language, the coefficient C critical is of order pi squared. No, it's of order pi squared, is pi squared, sorry. The coefficient C critical is pi squared, which means that the transition happens at strong coupling. Okay, so it's a big number. This coupling is a big number in units of our UV cutoff. This is 10 at strong coupling. Okay. But so the two thing I wanted to say is okay, we can erase. So first, let's observe that the spontaneous breaking generates a mass for our vector fields. And so the first comment is that the dynamically, the mass that is generated the sign depends on which of the two vacua we sit in. Depending on which vacua we sit, we get this. And this could still be, and this could still be much, much smaller than lambda. Okay, so there is still, we could very well be in a regime in which our vector particles are well below the UV cutoff, right? Just need to take G sufficiently close to lambda. This, I mean, in the broken phase, sorry, I should have said in the SB phase. Okay. If we are close to GC. So in that sense, I mean, it's not a big deal that we have a UV cutoff. We could go to the broken phase and still have particles which are well below the cutoff and study their scattering, okay? The more concerning thing, though, is that we did this analysis with this effective Lagrangian in which we have this largish value of C, and we completely neglected possible higher order operators, okay? So the thing that we should ask ourselves about is, what about higher dimensional operators? Okay, and so what we would do ordinarily in this context of effective field theory is that when we compute with this parameter C, then we need to systematically also include in our calculation higher dimensional operators. But the magic that happens here is that in 1 over n perturbation theory, the theory is actually renormalizable. Normalizable. And let's explain what this means. So again, the consequence of the lack of renormalizability in ordinary perturbation theory is that as we go at higher and higher loops, every time we need to add higher dimensional operators. And the statement I'm making here is that this is not necessary if instead we compute with large n, okay? If you do with large n, we can avoid doing that. And the reason for that is that, sorry, I'm just thinking about how to say it better. So the reason for this is that simply the higher dimensional operator that we would generate in ordinary perturbation theory are further suppressed by powers of 1 over n. Okay, let's try to give a concrete example of this to understand how it works. Suppose we worry about, so let's give an example. So what would be the first higher dimensional operator to worry about? So the cubic, so the one that is cubic in the bilinear, we don't really worry about that because it's forbidden by the symmetry, right? So the first operator we might worry about is something like this. So we have our quartic, but we also generate, so that's the correct scaling that we saw at the beginning for multi-trace operators. We can worry about generating a guy like this, okay? And this G is of dimension minus one, and Y is of dimension minus five, if you do the calculation. So what could be a diagram that generates that Y? So we're not gonna see all the details, if you can try to fill in the details, but let me just show you the idea. So, diagram that contributes to 8-point function at leading order you get a diagram, for instance, you can consider a diagram like this. So this is the kind of topology that gives you the largest effect at large n. But then you can go ahead and compute this guy, and you will find that you see this would generate y over n cube as coming from some four insertions of g over n, and then there is a factor of n. There is a factor of n coming from a closed loop. But then you see, if you do dimensional analysis, you see that you need some energy scale here in the denominator, needed by dimensional analysis. So what actually happens here is that since this energy scale is in the denominator, if you do the computation, you find a finite contribution to the 8-point function, okay? So this diagram is finite. So since it's finite, it really doesn't force me to add the Y coupling, okay? However, if I would be doing ordinary perturbation theory, I would continue and ask myself, how about this diagram? So in ordinary perturbation theory, however, I have this diagram. I have a diagram like this that I need to consider next. How about we just take this one loop, we take this one loop box and we insert inside something like this. Okay, for instance, we can do this. We insert a loop inside. And so let me give you a tool to estimate how this goes by doing some power counting. So if you do this loop of the fermions, I tell you that with momenta P that enters and exits, this scales like the root of p squared. Okay? And so you can go ahead and just try to think about the behavior of this diagram, just putting some moment on the internal legs. And you will discover that in this case, this is actually divergent. Okay? So you're, and you can also do it by dimensional analysis again. You take here a y over n cubed. And now you see, let's count how many g's we have. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. We have g over n to the power 6. And how many closed loops do we have? We have 2 closed loops, right? We have 2 closed loops. And by dimensional analysis, this was dimension minus 5. This was dimension minus 1. So now I need to put a beautiful lambda uv here. And this gives me that I will have a divergence. And I need to add the y coupling. However, look at what happened. Here we have n cubed, and here we have n to the minus 5. Okay? So this is suppressed at large n. Suppressed at large n. Okay? So that's the reason why we don't worry about these higher dimensional operators at large n. Now, you might say, but come on, now this means that if I go to the subleading order in 1 over n, again, I'm going to get the divergence, right? I'm going to get the divergence, and I'm going to be forced to add this operator. Well, not quite, because when I go to the subleading order at large n, it's not enough to consider this diagram by itself, right? At the same order, in the 1 over n expansion, I will have to consider the full chain of bubbles, okay? So, do I get a divergence at subleading order in 1 over n? And the answer is again no. And the point is that I cannot consider the diagram by itself. I need to actually add together with that an infinite series of diagrams that contribute at the same order. This is the full chain of bubbles. The full chain of bubbles. And this changes the scaling of this internal line, okay? If you do this resummation, the infinite sum changes the scaling of this propagator from root of p squared to 1 over root of p squared. Okay? So it's a bit like the calculations that we did in the. You remember when we resummed the bubbles in the ON model, then we saw that at small momenta, a new scaling emerged. Here it's the opposite. What happens is that at large momenta, a new scaling emerges, okay? Because G is an irrelevant deformation of the free theory. So actually at large momenta, a new scaling emerges, and this new scaling that emerges at large momenta saves you from the UV divergence, okay? Okay, so this is not like a complete proof of the normalizability in the 1 over n expansion, but it's like the gist of the argument. If you want to look at a more systematic proof, it's in the review that I put on among the references by Rosenstein, Warren Park. Okay, so we are happy. Now we are sort of convinced that it's fine to just consider this theory with the quartic interaction. And what are we gonna do next? We saw that there are these two phases, okay? The symmetry broken phase and the symmetry preserving phase. And now we could do very much the same things as we did in the theory of the one model. So we can start going and computing the quadratic Lagrangian for our fluctuations, and then scatter our fermionic quanta with an exchange of the sigma field, and compute, for instance, the S matrix of our quanta, of our massive particles in the symmetry broken phase, or the S matrix of the massless ones in the symmetry preserved phase. Okay? It's a bit the opposite as before. Now, when we break the symmetry, we give a mass to the fermions, so we have fermionic excitations with mass, and when the symmetry is preserved, we have massless fermions. Okay? And let me just give you perhaps the result for the propagator of the Hubbard-Satanovich field, and then you can try to compute and check that is what you get by resumming the bubbles. So, basically this is also going to show this argument that I told you here about the scaling that emerges in DUV. So, the exact Largent propagator of sigma hat now takes this form. It's 1 divided by 1 over g. Again, this is the classical piece. And what we have here is now the fermionic bubble as a function of p squared and of the mass. So let's just put the three-dimensional one. We are in three dimensions, so let's put d equals 3. And this f stands for fermionic. And then the Feynman diagram, if you just compute the Feynman diagram for this fermionic bubble, you find that this fermionic bubble, this is our B3F p squared m, you find this result. It's p squared plus 4 m squared times the scalar bubble. Okay, so the one that we know from the one model. So for this, I don't put any superscript, just the fermionic bubble. And then there are some new pieces. There is minus lambda over pi squared plus 1 over 2 pi m. Okay, so you can try to just compute this diagram and check that this is what you get. And as we saw before, this is essentially captures all the information about this exact propagator, captures all the information about the scattering of the fermions. And a cute thing that happens is that if we go to the broken phase, right? If we go to the broken phase, then we saw that there is this formula that m is equal to 2 pi lambda over pi squared minus 1 over g. So you see that what happens is that there is a cancellation between various terms in the denominator, okay? So that's what we computed before. So look at what we get. We get just sigma of p, sigma hat of minus p is equal to 1 over p squared plus 4m squared times the scalar bubble. Okay? That's what we get. And so you see, now when we do scattering, this means Let's go, for instance, to the S-plane, that on top of the usual two-particle branch cut, starting from 4m squared, that comes from the bubble. This guy over here, this prefactor that we found, produces also a pole in this matrix. And this pole is precisely at threshold. Okay, we have a pole that is lives precisely there at the threshold. So that's a bit of an unusual situation. Typically, what would be the case is that either we have a pole below the threshold, and that's a bound state, or we have a pole somewhere over here, and then it becomes a resonance, okay, because it can decay to a two-particle state. Here, what happens at the leading order at Vergennes is that we find this pole precisely at threshold. And if you want, you can think about it as a bound state due to our attractive interaction. But to be completely sure, one would have to do the subleading contribution and hope that this would move a little bit in that direction, okay? I am actually not sure if this has been done by anybody in this calculation, but okay, it would require to go to the subleading order, 1 over n, and see where this moves. I personally haven't seen it, but it could be that it's somewhere in the literature. So I personally don't know what's the destiny of this guy, whether it's going to become really a bound state or a resonance, but I think a bound state, okay? And then, from that propagator, you can also study the limit of, you can go to the critical point, and just like we did for the, just let me flash it here, because I also want to mention something else. So at the critical point, the propagator becomes something like this. one over G renormalized. So here I'm putting inside the linear divergence in the cutoff, plus square root of P squared over 8. So that's the formula you find. And now you can play very much the same game as we did in the scalar theory. Now the difference is that when you go to very small momenta, you find the free theory. Or when you go to very high momenta, you find precisely the new scaling that I told you before in this renormalizability argument. And that means that we have some UV CFT, okay? So maybe I shouldn't have written it there. Let me write it here. So now the situation is reversed compared to the scalar case. So we have some UV CFT. Now we have this scale G. So this is what you see emerging from the limit of root of P squared, much, much bigger than 1 over G. So the scale is G minus 1. And then you have the IR CFT, which is just free fermions. Okay, and that you see in the limit of P squared, much, much smaller than 1 over G. Okay, and using the same techniques that we saw this morning, you can go ahead and compute, for instance, the correction to the scaling dimension of the fermion in this interacting UV CFT. Okay, that's what we call the Gros-Neve CFT. Now, if it's okay to take 5 more minutes, yeah, I think we are still more or less. I just want to make a comment about what changes in this story if you go to 2 dimensions, okay? But first, let me ask if there are questions about the 3-dimensional one. Okay, so let me just make a few comments about the 2-dimensional case. Again, unlike 3D, we're going to see that in this case we don't have any phase transitions. We don't have two possible phases with a phase transition, but there is only one possible phase, it's realized. Okay. Now, G is zero, is classically marginal. And if we go and compute the derivative of the potential, that we need to set to zero. Now we have the trace in 2D, and the trace in 2D takes the following form. We have M 1 over G minus 1 over 2 pi log of the UV cutoff. So for consistency also here now I will use the UV cutoff. And the additional term that we get takes this form, M log M divided by 2 pi. Okay, so just like we saw in the ON model in 2D, now we start getting some logs, but the consequence of these logs is going to be different. So this is the piece that in 3D was the root of M. Sorry, it was the absolute value of M. Here we get this this log, okay? And now, let's look at the consequences. So what is the consequence of that log? The consequence of that log is that now, regardless of what is the sign of this first parenthesis, you remember in 3D what happened is that this parenthesis was dominant near the origin in the M line. And so this would tell us what sign the potential has when we arrive at the origin. But you see, now we have this term which has a log here, and this log is always gonna dominate over this when we are very close to M equals zero, right? So it doesn't matter whatever we do here, it's always gonna have a negative slope, the derivative of the potential near the origin. So regardless of the sign of 1 over g minus 1 over 2 pi log lambda uv, the shape is, so the derivative of m has always this kind of shape. See, there is this negative term near the origin. So we always have three zeros. We always have three zeros. And this means that we are always in the symmetry breaking phase. So we have these two vacua. Okay. So in 2D, only symmetry breaking phase. Okay, so this is completely a non-perturbative effect because we started with some theory of fermions with some self-interactions, and we saw that it's always generated some condensate, some bilinear condensate of these fermions. And we can see this thanks to the Lorentzian expansion. And let's just make the final comment. Let's go and actually solve this equation. So this equation gives me so I can compute the actual mass that is generated for my fermions. This equation becomes log m equals log lambda minus 2 pi over g. Okay? So I can exponentiate it and look what I get. I get a beautiful formula like this. Okay? So it really takes the form of a dynamically generated scale. Okay? So this is our g invariant scale generated dynamically. And this is what gives mass to my fermions. And this also means that if you impose that, you see, my physical mass should not depend on the cutoff, you can get the following equation for the running of the coupling. This is just minus g squared over 2 pi. Okay, so this one loop exact at leading order at large n. Okay, so again, we see that there is a coupling which has a negative beta function. So in this theory, we have, again, asymptotic freedom and a fermionic bilinear that is generated dynamically, breaking the symmetry. And so it bears a lot of similarities with the four-dimensional non-abelian gauge theories, like QCD. Okay, I think I will stop here, and please ask me questions.